Good afternoon and welcome. I'm delighted to welcome Angela back to Downing Street today. And we've just had some very good discussions over lunch. We are two centre-right leaders who share a determination to secure a better future for our peoples by building stronger, more competitive, more open and more flexible economies. And we want to work together to achieve this. Our trading relationship is now one of the fastest growing in the world. And German companies now invest more in Britain than anywhere else in Europe. It is a win-win relationship. Together, German companies employ almost 400,000 people here in Britain, and there are 1,000 British companies currently employing over 200,000 people in Germany. One in five BMWs now has an engine made in the United Kingdom. I don't know whether the one you did drive up in Downing Street did, but I hope so. And we once again become a exporter of high-quality cars. We also want to strengthen our cooperation in other areas, from research and science to high tech. And I'm delighted that in a couple of weeks we'll be opening together one of the world's largest digital trade fairs in Hanover. Now, our discussions today have focused mostly on the European Union. We both agree that Europe faces an existential economic challenge, and it needs to change if it is to succeed in the modern world. The overriding task of the European Union today is to help secure the prosperity and the well-being of its citizens. That requires a more open, outward-looking, flexible, and competitive European Union. We want to work together with our fellow leaders to deliver that change. Now, we've already shown what is possible. Working together, we've cut the EU budget for the first time in its history, and we've got the European Commission to identify where they can cut EU red tape. Now we need to go further. We want to complete the single market so that our businesses can seize the potential of the world's largest market to expand and create jobs. We want to do more trade deals with all the corners of the globe. It would be a massive prize to seal a trade and investment partnership with the United States, and we're both committed to putting our full weight and efforts behind this. We want to make sure that the driving mission of the next European Commission is to help generate growth. And this amounts to a substantial agenda for reform and change. And as Angela has said, there are further changes that will be needed for the Eurozone. Those are changes that Britain supports. And there are changes that we need for Britain to protect our interests in the single market and to secure the support of the British people for our continued membership. Now, I set out my vision for a reformed European Union in my speech at Bloomberg a year ago. Today, we've discussed further some of those ideas for reform, ideas like how to cut the excessive interference and meddling by European institutions in our national life. We also need to guarantee the interests of those in the single market, but not in the euro. The discussions that Angela and I have had today are part of an ongoing conversation which will continue in Hanover in a fortnight's time and in the weeks and the months to come. It's a discussion that must, of course, involve our fellow leaders. In a Europe of 28 countries, it is hardly surprising that the process of finding and reaching agreement requires time, patience, and hard work. I want Britain to be a positive player in a reformed European Union, and I know that Angela wants a strong Britain in that reformed European Union. My objective is clear. I want to be able to say to the British people in the referendum that will take place by the end of 2017 that we've sufficiently reformed the European Union that they should vote to remain in it. But be in no doubt, it will be an in-out referendum. Finally, we discussed the situation in Ukraine, a clear example of where it is right for the nations of the European Union to work closely together. We both support a united and democratic Ukraine, and we support the aspirations of the Ukrainian people to live in a truly democratic society, under the rule of law, free from corruption and intimidation. We are particularly concerned by the situation in Crimea. Every country should respect the territorial integrity and sovereignty of the Ukraine. Russia has made that commitment, and it's important that Russia keeps its word. The world will be watching. This is not a zero-sum game. If the people of Ukraine want closer ties with Europe, greater trade, greater contacts, then of course we welcome that. But it is not about forcing the Ukrainian people to choose between Russia and Europe. It is in all our interests to have a stable and prosperous Ukraine that has strong relations with its neighbours, and that is what we should all, including Russia, work to achieve. It's important that I also say a few words about the situation in Northern Ireland. I've been clear that there was a dreadful mistake made by the PSNI in the John Downey case, and our thoughts should be with the families of those killed in Hyde Park in 1982. But it is important to set out the facts about what has happened. When we came to power in 2010, we inherited a process where letters were sent setting out the factual position on whether or not some individuals were wanted for questioning by the police. This process continued under this government. There was never any amnesty or guarantee of immunity for anyone, and there isn't now. But I agree with the First Minister of Northern Ireland that after the terrible error in the Downey case, it is right to get to the bottom of what happened. The case has already been referred to the police ombudsman, but as the First Minister has said, we should have a full independent examination of the whole operation of this scheme. So I can announce today that we will appoint an independent judge to produce a full public account of the operation of this administrative scheme to determine whether any other letters were sent in error. The judge will have full access to government files and to government officials. This needs to happen quickly, so this review will report by the end of May, and we'll publish the report. It's right that we take swift action. But let us also remember that Northern Ireland has made great strides forward as a result of the peace process. It's vital that we deal properly with the events of the past, but make sure this never undermines our determination to build a shared and prosperous future for the next generation, so that we never again return to the horrors of the past. Thank you. Angela.
Ja, danke schön.
Thank you very much, David, for your very gracious hospitality that you've offered to me and the members of my delegation here in Downing Street number 10. Let me say that it was a very great honor to address both houses of parliament. I set out my ideas about the German-British partnership very clearly in my remarks to Parliament. And obviously, we had the opportunity over lunch to further deepen certain issues. How do we envisage Europe for the next few years to come? And there is a lot of common ground here. You may well imagine that we did not get into technicalities here. We talked about the overriding goals, and those goals are growth. We need growth. We need more jobs. That presupposes that those countries that are in the Eurozone do their homework, that this monetary union is stabilized by them in such a way that we turn this into a resilient architecture, one that does not immediately that wards off in the future crisis for the euro, because that is what we all need for stable growing economies. Stable growing economies generate jobs, and this is too what we need. I'm very much looking forward to CEBIT. The United Kingdom is our partner country in CEBIT this year. We will be able then to show that our countries indeed lent a contribution to competitiveness, to our economies being at par, being fit for purpose in the global economy. And this is why I'm very much looking forward to your visit, David, in 2 weeks' time. If the EU is to emerge stronger out of the crisis than it went in, it needs to do its homework. And the exact dimension of that homework is something that we need to design over the next few weeks. We talked about the March Council and the agenda. Climate and energy will loom large on that agenda. There is a lot of common ground here, too, between Britain and Germany. And we also talked about the international agenda. Here in particular about Ukraine. The Ukrainian parliament today, with a large majority, voted Arseniy Yatsenyuk to be the new prime minister. I have great respect as regards the task the new prime minister will take over, and we wish him not only the necessary strength for his task, I think I can say for both of us that we shall do everything we can in order to support this government that has a tremendously difficult economic situation. Without reforms, the economic situation cannot be solved. We are also pinning our hopes on cooperation with the IMF, and we hope that Russia will also support cooperation with the IMF, where we are, after all, members. The issue of territorial integrity of Ukraine is of central importance to us. In my talks with the Russian president, however, I would like to say that I have seen that Russia is of the same view as we are on this matter, and this territorial integrity needs to be preserved. The Ukrainian government needs to resume its work, and all of Ukraine must see itself reflected in the work of this government. We know that there is a very large Russian majority in Ukraine, about And they, too, need to find themselves reflected in this government, in the work of this government. This will be of tremendous importance for the good and future of Ukraine. Thank you yet again. It was, beyond our ordinary sort of meetings, a very special event for me. And thank you very much for the support, David, you gave to me.